We'll go ahead and get started. I'm Ron Latz. I'm your state senator. And this is our annual pre-legislative session town hall meeting, flanked by Representative Cheryl Youakim and Representative Peggy Flanagan. We're going to make some opening remarks, give some thoughts on the upcoming session, and then we want to open it up to the floor and hear what you have to say, what your thoughts are, what questions you have, and we'll do our best to give you intelligent answers. How's that sound? We got a full house here. For those of you in the back, if you're having any trouble seeing or hearing, there are some seats still up in the front row. Don't be shy. Come on up and fill them in if you would like to do that. We're very excited. This is a great turnout. As I think some of you, there might be some more people wandering into. As you know, there was an accident out on Minnetonka Boulevard, which slowed some traffic down, including me. We wish well whoever was injured in that accident. This town hall meeting is being recorded for rebroadcast on St. Louis Park Community Television. So just letting you all know that. If you have questions, we'd appreciate you going to the mic that's right over there so that the audience that's going to be watching this on their television at home or on their laptops, however they access it, will also be able to hear the questions. That's pretty much it. So I guess I'll just jump right in. I serve in the state Senate. I'm a resident of St. Louis Park. This Senate district includes all of Hopkins, all of St. Louis Park, about half of Golden Valley, a quarter of Plymouth, and all of Medicine Lake. I'm married. My wife Julia is a lawyer, and we have three children, a high school junior, a high school freshman, and an eighth grader. So we've got a full and active household, a boy and two girls. I've served in the legislature now since January of 2003. I served two terms in the House, I succeeded Steve Kelly in the Senate when he vacated the seat to run for other office. I recognize Steve Kelly has joined us in the audience here. Steve, thank you for all your service to our community. Any other elected officials that are here before I move on, just so I don't miss anyone? Go ahead, identify yourself.
It's Karen Waters, St. Louis Park School Board.
Yes, Karen, just appeared in front of the school board last night. Karen Waters from the St. Louis Park School Board is here. Thank you again for your service as well. So I serve on three committees in the Senate. I chair the Senate Judiciary Committee, which is the policy committee. It doubles as the budget division for the Finance Committee. Then by virtue of that position, I serve on the full Finance Committee. And I also serve on the Commerce Committee in the Senate. Those are my current committee assignments. This upcoming legislative session is going to be fast and furious. We are starting about 2 months later than we usually do, at least in the budget sessions. This is not a budget session, although as you will hear, there will be a lot of budget conversation going on. So it's not unusual for us to start later in the spring, when we don't have the full two-year biennial budget to put together. This is unusually late in the year for us to get started, March 8th. We will adjourn right around May 20th or 21st, I forget the exact day this year, third Monday in May is the constitutional deadline for adjournment. In that time, we will address a bonding bill, a capital investments bill, which is traditionally the key focus of the non-budget year legislative session. In addition to that, there'll be a lot of policy initiatives. Then we do have a budget to deal with also. Fortunately, we have a budget surplus, or at least one might characterize it as more revenues coming in than the anticipated expenditures during the same period of time for this current biennium. We're going to have to fit all of that in between March 8th and the end of May. The first deadline for the committees, for the policy committees, for a bill to get out of the first policy committee in either house is just 3 weeks after session starts. So it gives you an idea how quickly things will move. Let's talk about the bonding bill for a second. Typically, the bonding bills consist of a lot of funds for U of M infrastructure, building renovation or new buildings, the Minnesota State Colleges and University System, similar investments there, and infrastructure throughout the state, sometimes water treatment facilities, and other infrastructure investments. That also includes transportation and transit sometimes. And the big issue this year, certainly for this district and the western suburbs, is Southwest LRT. We need to come up with somehow $135 million for the state's remaining portion of the overall cost of building the LRT line in Southwest Corridor. And whether it comes in a bonding bill, which is one place for it, or it comes in the form of cash out of a different source, or if it comes in the form of authorizing new revenue sources, for example, a metro-wide sales tax that would cover transit. Frankly, I don't care either way, as long as we're able to find that $135 million somehow. And I have carried the Southwest LRT funding every legislative session I've been elected to. And some years we've gotten some money. We've kept enough money coming along for planning. But this is the final do-or-die year, really, because the federal government has money set aside for us, and, if, and including in President Obama's budget that he's recently proposed. But if we don't meet our state's obligation this time around, we are very likely to fall off of the priority list for the federal government, and then you could be looking at 10, 15 years down the road, if at all, not only for Southwest LRT, but it will mess up all of the other transit investments with federal funding in the Twin Cities metropolitan area. So that's certainly a very high priority for us. On the budget side, there is a $1.8 billion surplus, and again, I use the term surplus cautiously, and I'll tell you why. State statute requires that one-third of that come off the top immediately to be put aside in the rainy day fund or in the reserves for state government finances. You may recall over the last 15 or so years, there have been many, many years where we've had shortfalls in our budget projections. We haven't had enough of a reserve fund in place. We ended up making substantial cuts in services. We ended up raiding one-time funds that weren't initially dedicated for that purpose, but were there for other purposes. We borrowed against future biennial revenues, for example, with the K-12 school shift, and never really had a structurally balanced budget going forward, because as soon as we balance this budget, the next one and the one after that were already projected to be in deficit because of the way we financed the current that current budget. We are not in that position now. We have a structurally balanced budget. We passed that budget last spring. And two things we didn't get done last spring, however, because of conflicts and how to approach them, were a tax bill and a transportation bill. Those two bills account for most of what we are now characterizing as a surplus. The Tax Bill Conference Committee, when it finished meeting without reaching a conclusion, was right around $590 million or so. And everybody knows that our transportation system is in dire need of investments. As I recall, the last number they were working off was around $700 million. So right there, you've used up over $1.2 billion just with those two bills. On top of that, the governor has proposed, and I fully support the idea of broadband investment to help Greater Minnesota get high-speed internet to the businesses and residents who live in Greater Minnesota. Governor's proposed a $100 million investment there, and the Broadband Task Force has proposed a $200 million investment there. In addition, the governor, and I think all of us up here, certainly share a priority of making substantial investments in early childhood, pre-K education. And there are various ways to approach that, and I've got two experts on either side of me who will talk more about that, who've done a lot of heavy lifting in that area. But that's also carries with it a price tag. And then every other area of the budget is also looking for additional funds. K-12 education would like to see additional money, for example, for teacher retention and training. Within the judiciary budget area, there's a lot of interest in how to deal with the prison population, the overpopulation of the state prisons, or the lack of prison space, if you look at it from the other point of view. The courts are looking for security investments for courthouses throughout Minnesota. And so there are a lot of investments we can go into in more detail there. And then every other budget category also has things that they'd like to do that they weren't able to fund in the last budget cycle, and things that have come up in the last year that they think are higher priority now. So we have all of that to focus on in this short session. With the same ideological and philosophical divisions in the legislature that we had last spring when we weren't able to reach agreement on some important issues. So it's going to be a very intense legislative session ahead of us. And I'm going to stop right there because we can certainly get into policy as well, and there's plenty of policy to talk about, but I want to make sure that my colleagues have time to make some presentations before we open up the floor. So thank you. Cheryl?
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming out here tonight on this unseasonably warm February night, which is great. I just finished my first year in the legislative session. For the 9 years before that, I served on the Hopkins City Council. My district covers all of Hopkins and half of St. Louis Park from Minnetonka down south, which you're in right now. I have three kids. My husband and I have three kids, a 20-year-old, 19-year-old, and 16-year-old. We have two away at college at U of M Morris and one still up at the high school. My husband teaches up at Hopkins High School and has for 21 years, and I just had the opportunity to spend the interim working up there for the last 5.5 months as a paraprofessional, mostly in the halls and study hall and working with at-risk kids. So it was very enjoyable and very eye-opening. I serve on three committees. Government Operations and Elections, Property Taxes and Local Government Division, and I just got placed on the Higher Education Committee that is both Policy and Finance after Representative Winkler left. So I'm very excited to start that new committee and learn a lot more about higher ed. I've been listening to all the old hearings from last session and meeting with folks. As Senator Latz said, probably our number one initiative this year is getting Southwest Light Rail done. We talk about only needing $135 million. To put that into perspective, that's just roughly less than 8% of the total budget. And it's the only part that's holding up the entire line. And while it seems like we've been planning for almost a decade, I know in Hopkins they had been planning for close to 30 years. So we really, really need your help to get that pushed across the line. If you are in favor of the line, I really would encourage you not only to contact Governor Dayton, but to contact Senator Dibble, Representative Tim Kelly, who are both transportation chairs, but then also to contact Representative Dowd, the majority leader, and Representative Davids, who's the tax chair, and Senator Scoy, who's the tax chair, because our transportation and tax bill are probably going to become inextricably linked this year. As Senator Latz said, we left some money on the table to the tune of about $1 billion to take care of things we were supposed to take care of last year. We didn't get our job done. We didn't come out with a comprehensive transportation bill, and we didn't have a tax bill that would have given some property tax relief. So while a lot of people are talking about a surplus, I keep looking at it as an overdue notice. The bonding bill is also what we'll be focused on this year, and to kind of wrap your heads around what bonding does, it's usually for infrastructure, either new or ones we need to upkeep. So if you can kind of think about it, it's to pay to build a house, but not to heat it or to furnish it. It's to pay for a new fridge, but not the food that goes in it. So there's a lot of infrastructure around the state that different state agencies own. Also, individual cities that want to partner with the state agencies or state for bonding money for different projects also, and then private entities that are looking for public-private partnerships. Senator Latz and I are both carrying a bill to help perspectives the local St. Louis Park nonprofit expand their early childhood center. So other than that, we also, it's a bonding and a policy year. So traditionalists, I'm kind of a purist that way, would think policy first, good policy, and then money to follow good policy to implement it. But we actually have the policy part at the second year of the biennium, so there'll be policies coming forth that people get passed that'll actually take some money to implement too that might chip away at whatever is left of the budget. I personally have one. I passed a Silver Alert working group last year to see if we needed something similar to an Amber Alert for those with Alzheimer's and dementia that may go missing. The bill passed. The BCA, the Bureau of Criminal Apprehension, conducted the working group and looked at what we already had in place, and the recommendations came back in January saying that they would prefer if we beef up our current emergency action network and do some outreach to local law enforcement on training for Alzheimer's, also on how to access the emergency action network. And it's going to cost a tiny bit of money, like $470,000, that I'm going to try to get this year. So you'll see a lot of that too, where policies get passed that have a little price tag to them too. So that's kind of the lay of the land. It will be very, very fast and furious. 10 weeks is not a lot to get things done, especially when you're doing more than you would traditionally do. Not only do we have the bonding and policy, we also have transportation and tax bill. And for some reason, everybody's also focused that this is an election year too. So that tends to change people's personalities as you go through the process. So it should be very interesting. My major concern is that there's not going to be enough time for public input and for people to really come together and talk about the policies and the bills. So be loud very quickly and let us know where you stand on the issues. It's really helpful to see this room really full tonight, and I look forward to your questions. I'm going to kick it off to Representative Flanagan.
Thank you, Cheryl, and thanks. Thank you, Ron. I'm really excited to see everyone here tonight. So I'm the new guy. I was elected just this past November in a special election and took Representative Ryan Winkler's seat. So this will be my first session, and sort of coming in halfway through as a bit of an adventure. I'm really excited that I now know how to get to my office in the easiest way possible in the state office building. And am now have my committee assignments. So I'm serving on education, innovation policy, as well as public safety finance. So we'll be working a bit with Senator Latz. And then I took Representative Youakim's seat on the Rules Committee, so I can find out like how things actually work, right, at the legislature. My priorities for this session will be, of course, Southwest LRT. As you've heard from my colleagues, there's a real urgency to this. And as we're looking to, the growth and expansion of our community, that's really critical that can happen. And one of the things, we were recently at Hennepin County meeting with the commissioners and other folks from the county looking at Southwest LRT and other transportation issues. And sometimes we get pushback from our colleagues in Greater Minnesota regarding making investments in Southwest LRT and other transportation initiatives in the metro. But what was really eye-opening to me is we saw this map. It was pretty powerful. It talked about where folks who are working within on Southwest LRT or on the light rail in general, sort of where those folks were coming from. And a lot of the folks were coming from Greater Minnesota for these jobs. So when we talk about initiatives in the metro, it's not just about right here in our community. These are things that also serve the entire state of Minnesota, which is something to keep in mind. I will be continuing Ryan Winkler's work around paid family leave. I'm working very closely with Representative Jason Mehta on this initiative, and Jason Mehta sort of holding up the elder care side of this, and I am holding up really looking at families with new babies, new adopted children, or families who need to take care of a child, and knowing that we have too many families who are making the choice of caring for a family member or going without wages, and think that, you know, it's high time that we have an opportunity where parents and family members don't have to make that choice. So I'll be working on that, as well as I serve on the Select Committee for Childcare, which is a new committee that we've put together. We're doing listening sessions across the state of Minnesota, looking at the affordability issue and access to childcare in the state. I have a three-year-old daughter at home, Siobhan, so I'm very familiar with childcare, and know that this is something that many families are struggling with. Right now, in the state of Minnesota, we've got over 7,000 families on the Child Care Assistance Program wait list. And these are families who want to work, and it's simply the high cost of childcare that's preventing them from doing so. I look at my own family. I was a CCAP kid. My mom was a single mom, raised me here in St. Louis Park, and she used the Child Care Assistance Program to go back to school, get a good job. And this was really the program that helped lift my family out of poverty. So I see how well it can work, and I think that we need to figure out how to make more robust investments in this program. And of course, the hot topic, which I'm sure we'll talk more about, around early learning scholarships and universal preschool. So the good news is there's a lot of energy around early childhood in the state, and that is tremendous. Right now, we're trying to figure out what's the best way to serve our littlest Minnesotans. And so I think, you know, we've talked about several combinations of that, and this will be, again, a very robust conversation. But I do think that this focus on early learners is critical as we're making investments now, so that down the line that we'll be able to have kids, children and families who are economically secure, who are learning and reaching their full potential. So I'm eager to dive into that work. The last thing that I will mention is I also served on the work group on racial and economic disparities, which was me. I'm ready
with addicts more than you are with people who are using it for purposes of making money and profit and enterprise. Not always the case. I'm generalizing here, but our statutes do generalize by necessity. So the Guidelines Commission, led by Associate Justice of the State Supreme Court, Christopher Dietzen, and by a 7-3 vote, has proposed to reduce the number of months that would be a presumptive commit to state prison for those who are first-time offenders charged with first- or second-degree drug offenses, possession and sale. And that means thresholds of 25 grams or more, for example, of cocaine for those for whom that's significant. And there are those for whom that amount is a two-day supply if you're an addict. And for others, they can use it to cut it and distribute it. But it's comparatively, and law enforcement will disagree, some will disagree with me on this, but it's a comparatively small amount compared to what the major drug dealers carry around with them to distribute in our communities. So the whole premise of this is in part to bring this in line with the way judges are sentencing people around the state. What has happened is individual judges, in the cases in front of them, are deciding to depart from the presumptive sentence guideline number of months. And they have that authority under current sentencing laws to decide if certain circumstances or factors are present. They can sentence someone to fewer months in prison. And they've been doing it so often all around the state, and it varies a bit around the state, but they've been doing it so often that the guidelines no longer bear any significant relationship to actual sentencing practice. And so the Guidelines Commission is proposing to change the threshold amounts so that the presumptive sentences so that they basically align with the actual sentencing practices of the judges and the prosecutors and defense attorneys who are involved in those cases around the state over the last 10 years. So there are those that disagree with that approach. Representative Cornish is one of them. His proposal is to pass a law to undo that Guidelines Commission change. The Commission's change takes effect August 1 if the legislature does not pass a law to change that. So there are a lot of moving parts, or a lot of parts to the Guidelines Commission recommendations, and I won't go any further into detail on that right now. They did make some recommendations for statutory changes, including some heavier penalties for kingpins, but those require changes in the statutes. But if we don't pass a law undoing what they've done, then their changes become effective. So my view is that the Guidelines Commission changes ought to become effective. I feel quite strongly about that. And just to give you an idea of where we are compared to the nation, right now if you're convicted of a first-time offense, possession of 25 grams of cocaine, your presumptive sentence is 86 months in state prison, over 7 years in state prison for possession of 25 grams or more under current statute with intent to sell. And basically that's presumed if you've got, any inkling. If you give it to someone else, it doesn't require an actual sale. The next closest state is Missouri, and theirs is 49 months. And from there you get to Oregon and Washington, and you're talking about 16 months and lower than that. Federal law, everyone thinks federal sentencing is so strict for drug crimes, 10 to 16 months for the same offense. And these are comparison states that the Sentencing Guidelines Commission has selected because they've got similar sentencing structures in terms of guidelines and grid sentencing grids, determinant sentencing. Other states without that kind of a grid also, even Texas and Florida, have lower months of sentencing than Minnesota does. So that puts it in some context for you. On the voter restoration, I was very heavily involved in attempting to pass voter restoration last year that would have authorized people who are convicted of felony offenses, all felony offenses covered in this case, and they've served their time in prison. They're released from prison. They're back in the community and paying taxes, taking care of their family, consuming public services, and importantly, participating in community activities like everyone else does, yet they don't have the right to vote in Minnesota. Frankly, there aren't a whole lot of states anymore that do it this way, but that's been Minnesota law for a long time. And unfortunately, we ran into a roadblock with the Minnesota House majority last year. They absolutely refused to go along with it, so we were not able to get that passed last year. The same people are in charge in the House of Representatives this year, and so I don't expect that there's going to be any significant change. I've personally reached out to Speaker Dowd on a couple of occasions since the end of last legislative session, and because he had indicated he would talk and think about it, but he's never gotten back to me. So I think it's going to be very difficult to make any progress there. But for me, it's two key fundamentals there. One, it's taxation without representation. These persons are back in the community earning money, paying sales tax, paying income tax, they're paying taxes, but they're not able to vote for their own representatives. And then secondly, we want these folks to be able to successfully reintegrate into the community. We want them to be successful for the safety of all of us. And if they can get a job, if they feel like they're a part of the community and have a voice in the public life, they're more likely to not only be good role models for their children, but also remain more law-abiding. And there's actually some studies, there's one out of Florida that draws a link between recidivism and these kinds of policies. So I think we're all better off if we can restore the vote to persons once they're out of prison. I don't expect to see any progress this year, however.
Yeah, I'll just quickly just add too with the drug sentencing reform. Although judges have been departing, and in some cases up to 75% from the grid, so they do have the capability to do it, but we want a uniform justice across the state. We don't want to have it indeterminate depending on who happens to be having, let's say in Cook County, they decide, nope, we're not depart, but down in the metro area they will. To have a fair justice system, it has to be uniform, and that's why we have the sentencing guidelines grids to begin with. So I'm really hoping that Representative Cornish doesn't get any traction with his bill, and he just lets, because the Sentencing Guidelines Committee has been looking at this for, oh my gosh, quite a few years. So a lot of thought went into this by experts in the field that are working every day in and out. So, and then with the voter restoration, it also clarifies something in folks' minds. When you serve your time behind bars in a structure, then you serve your time outside on probation, it can be really confusing about what you're allowed to do or not do. And this really, and Representative Simon used to explain this really well, it puts a bright line there so they understand you are now entering society, you are now expected to get a job and be civically engaged and be part of your community, but oh yeah, there's this one thing you can't do. So we really, really, really need to get that passed. And once again, I'd make a plea to to have you all. If you are very interested in this issue, email Representative Dowd's office, have your friends and family in other parts of the state, email Representative Dowd and Governor Dayton and let them know how important it is. The Senate's already done their job to get this done, so.
And it's not a purely partisan issue either. I mean, there are a lot of Republicans that are agreeing with this position, but many of them are finding it difficult to step out among their colleagues and be advocates for it. I think if we ever got a floor vote in the House, it would surprise people how many people would actually end up voting for it.
Mm-hmm. I, of course, support the guidelines. I think, you know, one of the things that Representative Youakim also highlighted is just the disparities within sentencing that we see as well, depending on what community folks are from. I was part of the Restore the Vote Coalition through my work with Children's Defense Fund. Our position on that in particular is that voting should be a family value and being civically engaged should be part of that. We should be able to model that, for our children and families. So my hope, and I remember talking to Senator Latz about it, and and he said people just need to keep the pressure on, need to keep organizing. There's been a lot of energy, especially in our communities, from young people, and I think that that's really key and critical to continue to move this forward, knowing that sometimes it takes a couple sessions in order for things to get done. Yeah, or 10 years.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
David Pacheco from St. Louis Park, recent resident. I would like to actually express support first for the Voting Restoration Act. I think it's really critical and very, very overdue. I would like to ask a little bit more about the Prison Population Task Force, something Representative Flanagan, you just touched on, actually, which is, will the task force be looking at racial disparity in both sentencing guidelines but also in the current prison population?
Well, I co-chair and I established this prison population task force, and my co-chair is Representative Cornish from the House, who chairs the counterpart committee to the Senate Judiciary Committee. And by the way, he and I get along very well on a personal level. We just have some substantial disagreements on policy, which is, it's fine. That's part of the process. The task force was intended. And by the way, it's not a statutory task force. It's informal. So it doesn't have any formal powers delegated by the legislature. It's not going to take any formal votes on recommendations and has no force and effect of law, whatever it does. It's more of a forum to generate information and ideas and have conversations. But its intent was to look at how to deal with the difference between the number of people who are committed to state prison and the amount of space that we have in state prison. We are now about 530, 540 people overpopulated in the state prisons, and those extra 500 or so people are being housed in local county workhouses. The long-term trend is upward, over to over 1,000 by 2020. We're expected to be overpopulation. And so the question becomes, do we build more prison space, or do we find ways to reduce the need for that much prison space? And I personally think that there's enough room. I mean, it's pretty hard to get into prison in Minnesota. You have to have quite a criminal history to get there, typically. Not entirely, as we talked about in the drug sentencing area, but you have to work pretty hard to get yourself into prison. But there are areas where we can still do things that can reduce the need in the first place to commit people to prison, and importantly, I think, to give them incentives and performance criteria to qualify for early release programs. Chemical dependency treatment, mental health treatment, there's a challenge incarceration program, a lot of things that we can do within the population that's already in prison to help them be prepared to leave perhaps early, and then also to not recidivate, not to commit new offenses or commit violations of their release. Nothing in there was intended originally to address racial disparities. Racial disparities are a very, very important issue, a very important question. But the question before the task force is large enough to wrestle with without having a whole nother important and wide-ranging topic layering on top of it. And certainly these issues are infused a bit. I mean, you can't always separate it. There's no doubt there is a disproportionate number of people of color who are committed to prison in Minnesota, coming out of communities of color. And this is not only in drug crimes, but in other crimes as well. And there's a whole host of reasons that, you know, generate that result as well. And we, frankly, could have had a whole nother series of five or six task force meetings just on the issue of racial disparities in the criminal justice system. And not only prison commits, but enforcement and the laws, the statutes themselves. And so we just aren't in a position to tackle that as a separate issue in the prison population task force. So it had less to do with the makeup of the population in terms of race and more to do with the numbers of population and the kinds of offenses that have gotten them there or release violations that have brought them in. It is my hope that we will be able to take other venues, other places that we can address racial disparities. And certainly, as we are having conversations about what to do with statutes to address some of the numbers issues, racial disparities will be taken into consideration as well. But thank you for raising the issue. It's very important to deal with.
I think part of what you see, too, is the lineup on the way to prison. And also, when we talk about the sentencing guidelines, you got the criminal, the act on the left side of the guideline. On the top, you have a criminal history score. And a lot of the stuff that goes into that criminal history score can be things that are gross misdemeanors or things that build up with kids, starting out with kids, that end up, let's say, if you steal more than $1,000, it's a felony. So an 18-year-old can make a really dumb decision and steal two iPhones from Target and end up with a felony on their record. That might get put down to a gross misdemeanor, but let's say then he and his friends have a small amount of marijuana or they get a traffic fine that they don't pay. I mean, those things can add up to criminal history scores that end up really hindering our youth as they get older. So I think that part of it is where the discussion also needs to be with the racial disparities when it comes to sentencing, is that lead up and educating our youth. And we could spend all night talking about it, but I'll leave it at that.
I think one piece, just sort of an answer to your question, but also speaks a little bit more broadly, is that Representative Thiessen has introduced something called a disparities indicator. And I don't know how much traction it will get, but I do think that it's something that's important to look at. So the same way that we look at, you know, like a fiscal note or how much would this cost, is how would this directly affect communities of color? And to see if there's a way for us to start to look at, as we see these gaps, how are the policies that we are implementing actually affecting these gaps? So it's a one way to start to actually like look at and measure. Instead of sort of this being a loosey-goosey, you know, broad sort of theory, a way for us to get some hard numbers on that. So it's something that I'm certainly interested in and would encourage you to reach out to others to include support for it, because I think that speaks directly, you know, to this issue across, you know, communities. Yeah.
Thank you. Bill.
Hi there. I'm Bill James, St. Louis Park. Good to see you. Senator Latz, Senator Youakim. The new guy, Representative Flanagan, gets a break on this question. So I just want to talk about one thing that was made progress on last year during the legislative session was Sunday liquor sales. We passed the craft brewing bill, and we can now buy growlers on Sundays when we visit our local craft brewer, like right over here at Steel Toe Brewing. I find it a little bit ironic. I can go in there on Sunday and buy a growler of beer and take it home and enjoy it, you know, in the right way. I can't literally walk over 600 yards to Byerly's and buy the same beer on Sunday in the same glass bottle. Recent polling data has indicated, in fact, the Minnesota House conducted a poll last year during the state fair that 64% of Minnesotans polled support Sunday liquor sales. The Minnesota Coalition Alliance pegs it at almost 77%. 15% said no. And the revenue streams that have been projected for additional tax revenue to the state is north of $15 million per year. So not to put you on the spot, two of you voted no on this last year. I'd like your thoughts on that, and actually I'm asking for your support on legislation to take this across the finish line. It's affecting the competitiveness in the state. We're the only state surrounded by five other states that allow this, sales to take place on Sunday, so we're at a competitive disadvantage. People do drive across the border to purchase liquor. They drink across the borders, and then they come back into the state, so there's a whole range of issues there to pay attention to. And I just like your thoughts on that. Thank you.
Yeah, I did. It was my first experience with Sunday sales. It was an amendment on the House floor. I voted no for a few reasons. One was there had been a lot of work done on the omnibus liquor bill to come forward so far, and I was a little concerned about putting an amendment on it. Two, I had talked to many of our small business owners in town that own liquor stores, and their concern of what it would do for their overhead. They are having a tough struggle with the bigger chains to begin with. And since their business models have been set up this way for so many decades, I think it's going to take some time to make that switch. I think a lot of them are starting to think about it now, and they're thinking about it as they're either expanding or looking at new staffing, and they're hearing more from their customers. There is some statistics that also show that that's not going to be that much increased sales in liquor just because it'll be spread out over 7 days instead of six. My position is still evolving. I was a no to start with. I'm still hearing from folks. I'm hearing a little bit more from constituents. I still hear a lot from small business owners. So I look forward to hearing what you guys think.
I'll pretty much echo what Cheryl said. For me, it's been primarily an issue of the small businesses, especially the family-owned liquor stores that don't want to have to work 7 days a week. They'll feel the competitive pressure to be open on Sundays if their big box neighbors are open. And it's going to add overhead for them, which at least the ones I've been speaking with, they don't think it's going to add anything to their bottom line in terms of quantity of sales. Maybe a little bit different in those border communities, but probably not too many people from St. Louis Park driving 45 minutes to Wisconsin to buy a six-pack of beer.
Unless it's Spotted Cow.
Unless it's Spotted Cow, right?
Guilty.
Yes, yes, yes. If they bring back the keg, they're in big trouble, right?
That's right.
Yeah, yeah. So the issue really hasn't had a lot of traction among the general community in the past. People are starting to think more about it now, and we're starting to hear more. But I guess we'll have to see. I've never closed the door on the issue, but that's where I've been so far, and I guess we'll see what the community voices have to say on it. So,
sure. So new guy let off the hook. I didn't vote on it last year because I wasn't there. I'd say this. My email inbox is now, clearly there was an action alert that was sent out because my email inbox is being flooded by people who are talking about Sunday sales. I think the concerns about small business owners are very true. I also think, you know, in hearing from the owner who is now out of business at the Four Firkins, this was something that he cared very passionately about. And so I too need to educate myself a bit more on the issue. But I tell you what, it's clearly important, but I wish I would have heard a little bit more about like early childhood issues than Sunday sales. But, you know, I know that people feel passionate about it, and I expect to hear from more folks. But do know that the big box sort of retailers in town are hurting folks, but I've also heard from people who say, you know, small businesses should have that option, or liquor stores, but folks who feel concerns about like Target or Buyerlease having that option. So I think there's a lot of conversation happening right now. So I also am in the position of needing to educate myself, and may have also driven to Wisconsin at a time to get some Spotted Cow on Sundays to watch football.
Captain in Wisconsin.
That's right, of course, yep.
John Cummings, Minnesotans for Safe Driving. I actually have some good news.
Yay!
Talking about the prison population, the first thing the Star Tribune came out that the felony DWI law was the first thing on their list. 700 guys in there. But, and I helped work with Amy Klobuchar passing this law, since it's been passed, traffic fatalities have decreased from 239 in 2002 to 111 in 2014. That's better than 50% decrease. That's huge. I hope they don't mess with that, because I do a lot of restorative justice work. I spend a lot of time in the prisons. I've actually had people tell me that they're thankful that the hammer came down on them, because there was no way that they were ever going to quit drinking if they hadn't been put away. And these are some of the most dangerous people to every family in this state that are out there. And like Ron says, you got to work hard to get in there. It says 4 and 10, but very few of them get sent in after 4. They get probation, and they screw that up, and then they might get in. But they're there, and the numbers say it's working. And also, as far as the Sunday sales and all this going to add to the taxes revenues, I just got some information today. We take in $165 million a year alcohol tax revenues. Cost of alcohol-related traffic crashes in statewide is $202,243,700. So that's not a very good deal for the taxpayers, because we got to take up the rest of that. And that's just the crash-related costs. What about all the other stuff, you know? They asked me to go to Lino Lakes. Would you like to talk to sex offenders? What in the world do I want to talk to sex offenders for? And they said, well, most of them are loaded when they do it, just like everybody else that's in there. And I says, well, sure, then I'll go and I'll talk to them. And, you know, we're trying to keep people out of prison. I'm on the DWI task force, the Hennepin County DWI court, and that's amazing. We got to have more of those courts. We have to have more of that kind of stuff to try to keep people out of prison, and it's working. So we'd appreciate you keep working on that, and don't let them mess with that felony DWI law, okay? Because it's working.
John, I'm not aware of anyone who's expressed an interest in repealing the felony DWI law.
Okay. Well, that's good. Good news. A lot of people will be relieved.
Well, and thanks for your work on the issue, too.
Mike Hinden, St. Louis Park, and this one's Peggy, you're going to get this one pretty fast. You'd mentioned early childhood, and I know that's a passion for a lot of us, and it's just equally as important a problem for a person who works for a small business or somebody who works for the big ones. And I thought as you were speaking, is there a way, or has anybody thought of creating a funding mechanism for small businesses, whether it's some kind of insurance program, or I'm not sure how to fund it, I even thought that. But small businesses have a problem with funding a person going out and paying for like 12 weeks of family leave. So has anybody thought of a funding mechanism to make it easy for small businesses to do that?
It's a good question. So right now the bill is being written. The bill will be similar to what's happened in California. So for example, in California, both the employer and the employee pay in. From some small businesses that we've heard from, they've been encouraged by this because it offers them the ability to give a bigger benefit than they would have been able to before, and to maintain more staff. The cutoff line of the size of that business is something that we're also currently discussing. So I know that within the committee of folks who are putting it together, that's certainly a hot topic and something that we're looking at. So as that develops, I'll be able to tell you a little bit more about it.
And the next question, I guess, is Ron's, but has anybody thought of creating a system where people who have served their time and have proven that they're responsible and have, as some of them have said, grown up, that we can assure employers that they are safe to employ via a bonding system? create a bonding system that would assure an employer that if they hire this individual, that, you know, if that individual causes damage or creates some kind of problem that causes that employer a monetary issue, that there's a bond there that they can, you know, go after and be reimbursed. That would make it easier for some employers to consider hiring somebody who has gone through the system and has grown up. You know, and it would not be for everybody. It would be a selected group of people that have shown that they, in fact, are ready to be community members and responsible, et cetera.
Mike, I'm not aware of anyone who has thought about that. That's the first suggestion I've heard. You know, someone would have to take a financial risk there, and the question would be whether or not the state, you know, would back bonds like that, or whether it would be something in the private bond market or insurance company market that would cover something like that, and how would you fund it?
I was thinking more state. It just is a way to make it easier. And again, the state, someone in the system would have to work with the individuals to determine who's, you know, eligible for this program.
And the problem is it's really hard to predict.
Which is why you need the bond, because an employer, therefore, will...
True, and actually, probably the most effective tool to reduce recidivism is long-term stable employment. So what the state does, I mean, and these are statistics from the Department of Corrections themselves that have done a lot of analysis on various factors that reduce recidivism. And job training is important. Obviously, it helps you get a job, but keeping that job is even much more important. It's probably a bit risky to think that you can predict an individual's behavior well enough that, you know, even the state would take a financial risk to guarantee that they won't or pay off on a bond. I think that'd be probably going a bit too far. You can generalize, but for individual cases, it's much harder to make predictions about that.
But taking that risk as a state versus an individual employer sitting there saying, I don't want to have any risk of hiring this individual, and therefore that individual is never going to get a chance of being hired.
Well, there has been a proposal to change employer liability laws to limit their exposure to liability if they take a chance and hire someone that results in some kind of basis for a claim against the business for that individual employee's conduct. The idea hasn't really been that fully developed, but I've heard some discussion about that. You're a very creative thinker, and not just on this. You've come up with a lot of other ideas along the way, too. And so thanks for thinking creatively, and I appreciate the suggestion.
Hi, I'm Diane Steen-Hinderly, St. Louis Park, and I have a thing to direct to the elected officials up there, but also for fellow citizens in the room. We all got our park perspectives this week, right? And there was healthy community pride there, saying that St. Louis Park, our city council chambers, are the first in the state of Minnesota to have a hearing loop installed, and maybe some of you are using that. And then Minneapolis community pride, that was the first city in Minnesota to approve a cable TV franchise with CenturyLink. And now St. Louis Park has done this also, so that's good. And as far as my knowledge, Democrats in Minnesota, and that's a lot of us in the room, and, well, I should say you in the room and you up there,
This is a nonpartisan town hall meeting.
Right.
By the way, everyone is welcome, and no one is put down for their political affiliation.
But you collectively were Democrats were the first in the nation to put ranked choice voting in your platform. But now I hear that there are top-down efforts to try to get this out of the platform. And that's very concerning to me. I've been working on this for years and years, 22 years, actually. And I think it would be a regressive thing. And we need updated voting systems all the time. We're known as the brain power state, so it should be no surprise that we're the first ones to come up with this. I'm in Mensa, okay, so anyway, probably why. Or was. It got to be a little bit prohibitive, the dues and stuff, but I did test into it. So I want all of you when you go to the DFL caucuses to fight any measures to try to take that back, it's regressive to go backward. And then there's a bill, the local options bill, which is coming up for the legislature, so I hope that will advance. So I guess that's my spiel for the evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jeff Roy, and St. Louis Park, and this comment and question is for Senator Latz. How are you doing?
Fine, Jeff, thank you.
Good. I wanted to, I've been following the police body camera legislation, trying to get a handle on that, and it's very complex, the policies.
Good luck with that. If you figure it out, let me know.
Yes, yes, that's, I would agree. But one of the things that I noticed in looking at your legislation, which is certainly better than no legislation on this, and better than not having body cameras on police, I looked at Representative Peggy Scott's legislation, which I'm sure you're familiar with, and I get the impression, that her legislation provides much easier access to the public to body camera data, particularly in public situations. And so one question is, can you compare and contrast the legislation in terms of that particular issue? I understand with your legislation that if there is a incident in public where substantial bodily harm occurs, I think that's the phrasing, that the data is public, but in other situations where Peggy Scott's legislation would make it public, yours is not. And then I have to think of the, and I can't remember the individual who was killed, I believe it was in Chicago, where he was shot, I don't know, 16 times or something like that. I want to say Trayvon someone, but, and how he had, and how that body camera data had been kept secret for so long. And when it finally came out, it appeared pretty obvious that there was a problem there with the police officer's behavior. So then it gets me thinking of Jamar Clark and the fact that we don't know what happened there. So if you could speak to those points.
This compare and contrast sounds like a college exam.
It does, doesn't it? It does, doesn't it? And I'll step back and listen.
I'll try to do this succinctly because I don't want to use up, I could use up the rest of the time of the meeting talking about this issue. I carried the body camera legislation in the Senate last year. We spent three long hearings in the Senate Judiciary Committee, many hours in addition to that informally with stakeholders and people who were interested in just thinking about and drafting proposals. And the Senate as a body passed the bill that I authored. The House did not give it a hearing last year. The House Civil Law Committee did not give it a hearing. Here's the law right now, the State Data Practices Act, classifies data that is maintained by government. The default position is all data is public unless it falls into certain categories. Most relevant category in this case would be investigative data if a police investigation is open. Once that investigation is closed, if the case is not going to be charged out, then the data becomes public. If it is going to be charged out, then it remains classified, if you will, and not public until after the criminal proceeding is concluded. A lot of police departments and a lot of members of the public, including myself, believe that body cameras can be a very useful tool for law enforcement in their mission to protect the public and also for accountability of police officers as they are engaging in those duties. The question becomes, what happens with all of that data? And in part, who pays to store all of the data that's gathered? So there are a lot of issues surrounding this. The basic approach that I took, that the Senate ended up taking, was kind of a middle-of-the-road position on this. It wasn't agreed to or supported wholeheartedly by law enforcement. It wasn't supported wholeheartedly by the civil liberties folks. You'd be surprised where different organizations tend to fall on an issue like this, because there are some competing interests that it's absolutely impossible to completely reconcile in this case. If it were all about police accountability, there'd be a camera on all the time. It would always be public, and everyone would have access to it. If it were all about protecting the safety of the public and nothing else, the officers would use the camera and the data would be stored away and only used when it was necessary to prosecute a crime. Obviously, neither of those extremes are acceptable in our society, nor should they be. So you end up dealing with a number of competing interests. One is for those who are the subjects of the data, meaning the people who are on film, do they necessarily always want their images to be publicly available? And that may depend on where they are found or where they are filmed and under what circumstances they are filmed. Usually police are responding to calls for service for people who are at their very worst moments of life, either as potential criminals, offenders, perpetrators, or as victims of crimes who may not want themselves to be broadcast or publicly available in those moments either. And particularly if they're in their own home under those circumstances. The last thing that we would want to do is re-victimize persons by making certain videos automatically publicly available. And when I say publicly available, I don't mean just to the individual that may have an interest in the matter going down to the police department asking for a copy. One has to assume now that anything that is publicly available could be up on the internet, on YouTube, tomorrow. So any inquiring neighbor, any potential employer that is doing a background check would have access to any data that's made public. So I think it's important to find the balance where you can protect the privacy of those who want to have their situations and their images remain private, yet still provide for the public accountability that's important so that we can oversee, as the citizenry, the conduct of our law enforcement officers. What my bill does is it provides that when the officers are in a person's home, the officers have the discretion whether or not to turn the camera on or off, which is one of the points where the Senate bill differs with Representative Scott's proposal. And I can certainly go into more detail as to why I think the Senate's version is better. But when there is film that's done inside the home, it's basically private or not public data unless there are certain circumstances that would really justify it becoming public. In every case, the subject of the data would have the right to make the data public, the film public. So if someone felt that they were victimized by police conduct, they would have a right to ask for a copy of that recording and to release it to the newspaper or post it on the internet, whatever they wish to do. However, if there are other persons in the video that are identifiable who may not want their images plastered across the media, then the law enforcement agency or the government agency involved would have a duty to redact or obscure those images so they're not identifiable before the data is released publicly. When you get into public situations, the judgment of the Senate was, if you're out in the public, the judgment of the Senate was that, the issues relating to police accountability are most focused on use of force cases. Not to say that's the only time that there are accountability issues, but those are the most significant ones. And so those would become public when there's use of force involved resulting in injury to a subject of the data. One of the points in contention are, you know, what happens when there are First Amendment events, when there are rallies or protests going on? Can the police just walk around with cameras on all the time, filming everyone that's there? Representative Scott says no, not unless there is a particularized reason to believe there's some criminal conduct going on. The Senate bill is silent on that question. So it would basically be left up to the discretion of the law enforcement officers at that point. I guess maybe I will touch on the officer discretion a bit, because that's another point of contention with Representative Scott's bill. If an officer walks into a home where there's been a call for service based on, say, a domestic dispute, you may have various opinions among all of the subjects in the home as to whether or not they want their camera to be recording. You may have an alleged abuser saying, don't record anything, while the victim or the alleged victim may be saying, yes, please record it. On the other hand, that person may not be comfortable saying, please record it, if they know that the abuser has a different opinion. So then who makes the decision? And who's got control of that? And is it a homeowner? Or is it someone who lives in the home who's not a homeowner? What if you have kids in the family, young people that would be on camera if the camera's on and that data is automatically public? What if you got personal effects around, tax returns, art pieces, jewelry, whatever condition the home happens to be in when the police are called for service? So the solution in the Senate was give the officer their discretion, so frankly they don't have to sort out what the law is as they're entering a very potentially dangerous situation. If there's been fighting going on in the home, there could be firearms or weapons involved, a very dangerous situation for law enforcement officers to respond to. Let them make the decision about whether the film needs to be obtained under those circumstances. In most cases, they will film under almost all circumstances unless they think they're going to have trouble getting a victim statement if it's being recorded. And then once we have the data, we can sort out, you know, what its public classification is. So again, we have to be very cautious about automatically making public data that's recorded, especially in people's homes. Let me just touch on one other issue, and I'll stop on this one, which was the Chicago case. That's nothing at all like what this law would be addressing. The Chicago case it took a year and a half for this supposed investigation to occur. And only when there was a lawsuit and a judge about to make a decision did the political officials in Chicago decide, okay, now we're going to make a decision on whether to proceed with this prosecution, and we'll release the film publicly. So that was a complete, in my judgment, from what I've learned anyway, a complete abuse of the process. And by the way, there is a judicial bypass provision in the Senate bill, as there is in the Data Practices Act in general, that would allow people who believe that film ought to be public to go to court and ask a judge to release the film publicly. And that's actually what's happening now in the Jamar Clark case. It was characterized in the media as an allegation that the government is breaking the law by not releasing the data. But that's not actually what the lawsuit does. The lawsuit is simply asking the judge to exercise the judge's discretion in determining whether or not the public interest in having this data public outweighs the private interest in having an investigation that may possibly be tainted by release of data, or may taint, if there are criminal charges that result, the prosecution of anyone that is alleged to have committed a crime. So I think on all these cases that we would all do well to step back, and including in the Jamar Clark case, and not draw any conclusions about what happened and who's at fault and who did what until we learn more about what the investigative results are. Because no matter what the national tenor is, and I understand there's a lot of concern about police conduct, that doesn't say anything about the specifics of what happened in a particular case. And I think we would all do well to withhold judgment on what may have happened there until we see the results of the investigation, and then we can draw whatever conclusions are appropriate from those results. That case now is the investigation's concluded. It's at the county attorney's office for determination about whether to bring any criminal charges. And typically the practice in the Hennepin County Attorney's Office is to present the data to a grand jury and let the grand jury decide. If there had been body camera in that case, it might well have been very, very helpful in determining the outcomes. A lot of law enforcement agencies have been waiting until the state passes amendments to the Data Practices Act to address body camera data before engaging in or before buying body cameras. City of Minneapolis has made a decision to go ahead and to order body cameras as well, but they're going to have to sort out, you know, what they think the law means right now, or when that data starts being gathered. And then you've got the whole separate issue of the fiscal side, which is the storage of massive amounts of data, and even more expensively, the human resources that'll be involved in redacting those whose images are by law private, not public, when there's a request for public release of the data. So it's a long, detailed answer. I'm sorry if it's gotten a little overdone there, but obviously an issue I've spent a ton of time on. Very important for civil liberties issues and law enforcement issues as well, and I certainly welcome any input that you have, but the Senate's position is pretty well established on this one, and I'm hopeful that Representative Scott is willing to sit down at a conference room committee. And when the House, by the way, sorts out, you know, what their position's going to be to maybe pass a law this year so more agencies can be comfortable getting body cameras in their agencies as well for the protection of everyone that's involved. And the House has a lot to sort out. Representative Scott's position on this is not necessarily the position of the majority of her caucus. It's certainly not the position of her counterpart chair of the other committee that it will go to, who happens to be Representative Cornish. Who was carrying the House counterpart to my Senate bill. So once the House sorts out their position, then we'll figure out where the bill goes from there. Thank you. You're welcome,
John. I think you're all sensing a trend here. I just want to quickly add, too, this came up twice in the last 2 days for me, this issue. I was at a coffee shop talking with somebody, and one of our police sergeants came up in Hopkins and said, when are you going to get this straightened out? Our officers really want to have body cams. We feel it's beneficial to the whole community, but when Minneapolis is starting to roll theirs out, they're going to need 4 full-time staff just to handle the redactions. And in Hopkins, we barely have a staff over 25 to start with. So some of the smaller departments would love to have this because it protects the police and it protects the public, but they just can't afford until there's some set rules around what to do with the video. And I spoke today with the Minnesota Coalition for Battered Women, and they have concerns too about the privacy and the re-victimization, and how do you deal with the presumption of privacy in a home in a case happening versus somebody who's been sexually assaulted in a public setting, and where that public-private line is drawn to. So as Senator Latz said, there's a lot of different layers to think through this. Good public policy can take a long time and a lot of discussion. So.
I was falling asleep back there, I'm sorry. My name's Dan Kane, I'm from St. Louis Park. There's been a lot of talk about drugs and crime and enforcement, and I'm not going to change that. I run a substance abuse treatment program as well as several other corrections programs, and also had the privilege of chairing the sentencing guidelines through the 1980s, when we had kind of the feeding frenzy on the cocaine epidemic. And I want to give you credit for, you know, the Prison Population Task Force and the testimony that you took today. I think that the Guidelines Commission has taken the most substantive action it's taken in at least the past 20 years in bringing this forward. And I think the fact that you have to take action to stop it really makes it more likely that this is something that's going to pass, when in fact it's been discussed for about the past 15 years and nothing has been done. And but having said that, you know, I support the Guidelines Commission recommendation, but it qualified. I also support some of the recommendations that came out of the county attorney's office, particularly in relation to the fact that there needs to be a legislative fix as well. and I understand politically how difficult that is, and I'd be happy to go into more detail, but you know, the what we're doing is we're basically putting a Band-Aid on a bullet wound. You know, we'll stop the bleeding, but you still haven't done anything to fix the wound, and the wound is a flawed system. As long as there's a target for law enforcement and prosecution to shoot at, they will shoot at the target. And you can move the target, but all you've done is you've pushed the can down the road. There will take a legislative fix. Also, we have the issue of prison overcrowding. And I would hope that, and I support your position on trying to reduce the number of people in prison. I'm extremely concerned with the direction that some of the people are going in suggesting that we should either buy or lease Appleton. It's a substandard prison. It doesn't meet the qualifications of Minnesota. And if you read the story in the newspapers the other day, it seems that the biggest argument for it is that it'll help the economy of Western Minnesota. That's not the reason to put 1,000 more people in penitentiary. And furthermore, I don't believe government should ever abdicate responsibility for law enforcement or corrections. You know, that's what we elect our officials for. I believe that, you know, farming that out to a for-profit prison or a for-profit law enforcement group creates all kinds of opportunities for manipulation and problems. Having said that, there's another issue that's coming up that the legislature has ducked for at least the past 10 years, and that's the issue of the Minnesota Sex Offender Program. You know, Judge Frank has ankled to the legislature for a long time now that if the legislature doesn't do anything, he's going to do something. And we're now at the point where, in all likelihood, we've exceeded his patience. You know, something is going to come down. We have a trickle coming out of MSOP right now, but if he makes a decision, it's likely to be done with an axe as opposed to a scalpel. And the community is nowhere near ready to accept an increase in the number of sex offenders released from MSOP. We don't have the resources. We don't have the infrastructure. You know, we have very few places where people can be housed, and nobody wants them in their backyard. And, you know, by putting it off all this time, and I understand the political difficulty with that, because if you do something that looks like you're soft on crime, you're going to face somebody in the next election that's going to paint you that way. But if we don't do something, this is a disaster waiting to happen. And the other thing that I would comment on is, you know, you've mentioned chemical dependency treatment, and I think that, you know, having low-level offenders in the community in treatment is a much better solution than having them in prison. But at the same time this is happening, there's a problem with the Department of Human Services. And, you know, just to real briefly, with the Affordable Care Act, the state can now bill Medicaid for things that it used to pay for itself. One of the things that the state cannot bill Medicaid for is something called an IMD, or an Institution for Mental Disorder. And unfortunately, virtually every residential treatment program that receives public funding in the state of Minnesota is classified as an IMD. Now, the state has a way around that. They determine classification according to guidelines from CMS. But they've chosen to, you know, basically check a couple boxes as opposed to delve into the meat of what the guidelines suggest should be considered. And, you know, there were 31 programs that were classified. There are an additional 37 reclassified last December. And as I said, that includes most of the residential programs in the state. Now, if we're going to let people out that are currently in prison, and that not just the state, but President Obama has talked about letting 49,000 low-level drug offenders out, at least 600 to 700 who are scheduled to come to Minnesota, and we weaken the residential treatment system as a result of that, we again have a recipe for disaster. And I would hope that you guys would find a way to either direct the Department of Human Services to reclassify, to seek a waiver, which CMS has recommended that you seek,
but Minnesota, for whatever reason, has been reluctant to do that, or to provide a supplemental budget to subsidize the counties and the MCOs, or HMOs, if you will, that will have to pay more money because they won't be able to access federal money to pay for the IMDs.
One thing I'd like to thank you for bringing up the Residential Treatment Center. I was actually visiting Wayside House yesterday, and it's right here in St. Louis Park. It has 41 beds for women for chemical dependency, and it was interesting to also hear that 75% of their folks that they're treating also have a mental illness as well. And they, yeah, and they're an IMD, and they've been it was a hard transition for them with the ACA going to have some at the, it was easier to deal with the state to get the reimbursements than it has been to go through the ACA. But, you know, they're having those growing pains. But bottom line is we don't have nearly enough beds that we need now. And I am with you on the MSOP issue, and it's nice to hear that. I think it's about 58 now. They're in their last phase before they could be released. Or is it 63? I can't remember. It's more than it's been in a long time. So it's getting better. But we really need to build that infrastructure for folks, both that are in our community, coming out of prison, that have chemical health and mental illness issues and really need the treatment. So that's something to kind of keep out there in the front forefront, too.
I'll just say briefly, Dan, thank you for your comments. I agree with you on Appleton. I don't think you'll see anything happening with Appleton. Because I'm not the only one who agrees with you. I think there are a lot of others who do as well. The governor has, you know, he likes Appleton, but there are other things that, I don't think you'll see Appleton coming. The governor has proposed, as part of his bonding proposals, several smaller expansions of existing prisons, some renovation of space, some building out of some space on existing platforms, with beds mostly dedicated either to chemical dependency treatment or to expansion of the challenge incarceration program, which is boot camp, basically, and results in early release for those who qualify and successfully complete it. So there's about 120 beds, I think, total in the governor's proposed expansion, which will help ease a little bit on the crowding and will also help deal with longer-term population issues. The county attorneys do have some very good proposals for approaching this. I support moving toward the kingpin legislation, as I noted. The county attorneys support that, but there'll be some disagreement on, you know, what are the levels of quantities that would qualify for that. And by the way, in the Guidelines Commission recommendations, they have a number. The county attorneys successfully got a number of aggravating factors added into the commission's recommendations as well. On Minnesota Sex Offender Program, the Senate has been working this on a very bipartisan basis for a number of years. We've passed 2013, I think, we passed reform legislation. And the House, you know, on a bipartisan basis, was unwilling to take it up because in part it's so dicey and in part because I think of a lack of trust that it would be treated apolitically as just pure policy reform questions. Probably the lead in the state Senate has been Senator Warren Limmer, who is a Republican lead on the Judiciary Committee and the former chair of the Judiciary Committee when they had control of the body. And he was on the task force that dealt with this, has been a very strong lead on that. And he's tried everything he can and successfully among the Republicans in the Senate to take the partisanship out of this issue, because there are very serious constitutional questions, very serious cost issues here as well. And so I personally think Judge Frank is just going to end up having to do what he's going to do. I think it's an abdication of the legislative obligations to deal with it as a policy matter, but I think the politics of it are just too tough, you know, to deal with. So. There you have it. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. My name is Sally Gillette, and I live in Minneapolis, but I'm representing Wayside House as the board president. And I have a lot of the same kinds of comments that Dan had about, especially the IMD. That law was a federal law that mainly that dealt with mental illness and warehousing very vulnerable people. And it now is part of what is ruling treatment centers here in Minnesota. Already we have, we treat about 9.6% of all the people who need to be treated. We don't need things that limit treatment. And I think it's really interesting that I thought, gee, I'm going to be kind of a lone person talking about addiction here. And it's, wow, I'm really impressed that, you know, there's such an interest, because it does connect so much to who goes to prison and what happens to people when they get out. One of the concerns I wanted to bring was the, and I'm happy to see that you're part of government operations, is our Department of Health is overwhelmed, underfunded, working in chaos frequently. Good people, but having a job that seems too big. Treatment centers get bulletins. Sometimes we're supposed to deal with them retroactively, even. And when there is chaos, it filters down to our clients. And we want our clients to get well. I mean, that's what this is all about. So my plea would be that in, and I know in 17, not in this legislative time, we're going to be dealing with things like rule changes. And I don't think there's enough expert advice happening. And I would really recommend that the legislature form some panels of experts to help guide the legislature through so that good laws can be made. There are other things like making it possible for recovery coaches to have a code. If you don't have a code, you don't get paid. And so Wayside now has recovery coaches. These are unlicensed people who help folks hook back into the community and take advantage of their treatment for long-term recovery. So we would like to see codes change so that we can have the services that are necessary. Also expanding telemarketing. Wayside House has started telemarketing. I think you folks in St. Louis Park ought to be really proud to have Wayside House in its community. We have the Women's Treatment Center there, and then also a supportive housing on Jersey Shores. We also treat women and their children together and an outpatient program now too. So if we're concerned about not wanting to build more prisons and getting people out of prisons, funding and getting the right kind of rules in place, a good stable staff for DHS so that they can do their jobs. They're good people, but they have difficulty in doing what needs to be done. So thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Sally. Yep.
Sally, my grandmother, Mary Hartman, and then my auntie, Mary Hartman, were both the executive directors of Wayside House. So it's in my blood to care about those issues. And so, you know, through a lot of the work that I do just professionally, looking at DHS and how underfunded they are and stretched thin, that's certainly something that I care about as well, and look to 2017 to implement some of the solutions that you just talked about. Thank you.
Hello. Carol Rydberg. I'm delighted to be a part of a resident in the portion of Plymouth that is in this Senate district. I simply have a question.
Welcome to St. Louis Park, Carol.
I simply have a question. On this real ID, I believe that it's an effort to create a driver's license that will also verify our citizenship status. Is that correct? Is that what it's about? I mean, and if that is the case, I'm wondering how that's going to work. I have one document that verifies where I was born, my birth certificate. Unfortunately, it contains a name that I haven't used since I was 19. And because I've been divorced and remarried, it's actually two names behind. This is no problem for the men in the room. For many of the other women, this may be a problem. And I'm just thinking ahead, when we do whatever we need to do to create this real ID here, is it going to mean that when I go to get my driver's license renewed, I should bring my birth certificate, my first marriage license, my divorce papers, and my second marriage license to, in order to prove that the person who was born in this country is indeed the one who's using the name I now use? So how could you tell me, how is this likely to work?
Boy, well, we're still sorting a lot of that out, Cheryl.
How is it working? I understand we're one of the few states that doesn't have it.
Yeah, we're one of five states that has not complied with the federal requirement to upgrade our identification to meet the federal statutory requirements now. The Minnesota legislature in 2007, I think it was, actually passed a law banning the Department of Public Safety from spending any money, even planning, for the real ID. And our hope was that, and I think there were good reasons behind it at the time, our hope was that it would become a national effort to cause Congress to rethink the real ID law, which was a recommendation of the 9/11 Commission. In addressing the ease with which some of the people who hijacked the planes were able to obtain driver's licenses or identification and get through airport security. It turns out that there was not a groundswell of states opposing it, and in fact, almost all states have complied now with it. Minnesota has not even been able to plan for it. And it's gotten to the point where the federal government was saying, we're not going to allow you into federal buildings because your standards for giving out driver's licenses do not meet the more rigorous verification of identity that is now required. And to this day, right now, if you go to get into some federal buildings in Washington, D.C. with a Minnesota driver's license, you will not be allowed in. The part that's got most people concerned was getting on an airplane. And up until about a month ago, the federal government had said, had not said that they were going to extend the deadline for that, and we were up against the wall. They have now said they're extending that deadline again, so we're not under quite the intense pressure that we were. But we're going to have to start planning. Eventually, we're going to need to comply with it. And I don't think it's necessarily such a matter of citizenship as it is verifying one's identity. For whatever the form of identification is the state is issuing, so that meaningful background checks could be conducted if it became appropriate to do so. So I can't tell you what exactly you're going to need to verify who you are. If you have a passport, for example, you've already gone through that level of background identity, and bring your passport and it'll be fine. Not everyone has a passport either.
When I got my passport, though, they didn't ask me to verify that I was a citizen, really, not in the same way. I mean, I had the same problem then.
Well, but if you had a birth certificate showing that you were born in the United States, I mean, that would be evidence
of your
citizenship.
It shows Carol Colville was born in the United States, but it doesn't connect Carol Colville with Carol Rydberg in any way, shape, or form. That's the problem women have. I mean, our birth certificates don't have our names on them. I just wondered how it's all going to work, that's all, or how it's happening in the other 45 states now.
Well, my goal this legislative session, and Senator Dibble is the lead on this because he chairs a committee that would hear it first. Second, it would come to Judiciary Committee, and so I've been sort of second chairing this issue. My goal is to pass a repealer of the ban on planning money.
Okay.
So that we can start planning more carefully about this, and address questions like you've raised in terms of how we're going to handle that.
Well, I just hope I get enough warning and time. That's all.
I expect that you will. And by the way, there is an identification available in Minnesota that does comply with that, and that's the enhanced driver's license, which we passed a couple of years ago to allow people to get into Canada without having to bring passports or anything else, because Canada will accept an enhanced driver's license. It hasn't been taken up by a whole lot of people. I think only 15,000 people in Minnesota have used it. But for those who have, it's available now, and you can go apply for it if you wish to do so. And that's compliant with the federal Real ID requirements as well.
The enhanced license isn't available in all locations you get your driver's license, though. So that's something they're going to have to plan and look at, too, the accessibility of being able to do that. So.
Sir. My name is Stuart Hansen. And I'm a resident, a recent resident of St. Louis Park. I've been a physician in St. Louis Park for 41 years, retired several years ago, but I was at Park Nicollet and Methodist Hospital. I've been interested in prevention of disease and injury. So public policy has a lot to do with how our population health moves forward. And the thing I would like to get from you tonight is where you are on gun safety, and what might the legislature be doing in this session or the next session, the next couple of sessions, and you know, where you all three of you stand on gun safety issues.
So coming from the Children's Defense Fund, you know, we've been leaders in this work of gun violence prevention, ensuring, advocating for background checks. That's something as a child advocate I care very much about, and clearly as a physician caring about, you know, injury, it's clear that you do too. Again, this will be my first session, but I have to say, I'm not very encouraged to think that we'll be able to have much movement on gun violence prevention in the legislature, at least in this upcoming session. I think we've got to hear from more folks like yourselves, and in particular in greater Minnesota. My colleagues may share this as well. I believe, you know, hunting needs to be, you know, folks should be able to do that, but handguns and other things are, cause a lot of injury, a lot of death. We look at, you know, the high rates of injury and death to children in our community. It's appalling. I think it's clear that, you know, that folks care about this. And I don't know, I think many of us thought, you know, what happened in Connecticut, where we watched little children lose their lives, would have been enough to shake people. So it's going to take a lot of folks calling a lot of people. There's still a pretty big stronghold, I think, on a lot of folks in the legislature from the NRA and others. And so it's critical that you use your voice to contact, of course, us, but also our colleagues to express your concern. But I have I'm normally a very hopeful person. I'm not very hopeful that there'll be a lot of movement on that in this upcoming session.
I know that Senator Latz has done a lot of work on this in the past. I'll let him address that. I want to have a T-shirt that says I'm with her and him. I agree. I mean, all the polling shows people do agree, even NRA members, that we need comprehensive background checks, mm-hmm. that someone, you know, can go into a store and get a background check, but they can go online and buy a gun without one. And there's just something fundamentally wrong about that that's harming all of our safety. Also with straw buyers, somebody being able to go in and buy and purchase for other folks that might have criminal records, more teeth around that. And I know they've been working on that, but unfortunately we have the same folks that have stalled it last year and the year before and the year before that. So we just need to hear from a lot more people and people from all over the state. So once again, you may be preaching to the choir here, but I'm sure you have family members and friends in other parts of the state that could put a little pressure on some other folks. So that'd be great.
I agree with both of them, but I carried it's a Judiciary Committee issue. So we've had hours and hours of hearings over the last couple of years on gun issues. Cheryl's absolutely right. There's a broad support among citizens, and including gun owners, for background checks, for closing those loopholes, the gun show loophole, the online loopholes. I don't think we'll see anything passed this year, but we're working on building a base toward perhaps the following year, if we can accomplish that. The straw purchasers is still a big issue. I did carry the bill that did strengthen penalties against persons who act as straw purchasers. You still need the background checks, really, to be able to screen out folks. Not everyone who uses a gun has mental health issues, but there are some. And you can't screen out those who have mental health issues if you don't have a background check. And you can't do that without adequate data in the system either. So 2 years ago, we were able to fund putting in electronic form the commitment and mental health-related data in the courts that is necessary to fill the database for the background checks that the National Criminal Background Check System uses. So we've taken some small steps along the way, hopefully we'll be able to get to the background checks themselves somewhere down the road. It's not a partisan issue either on this one. You'll find members of both political parties on both sides of this issue. It's more, I think, of a philosophical and a geographic, mm-hmm. especially, issue. You know, in greater Minnesota, most of the gun deaths are suicides. And in the metro, they're mostly homicides. It cuts different.
Thank you.
Thank you. I do want to recognize, before I forget, we do have Ken Morrison from the school board has also joined us. He's been in the back of the room for a while, so I want to thank Ken for his service as well and recognize that he's here. And Jim Beneke, I see sitting there as well. Thank you. And Tim Brawson, I think, is here as well. There's Tim. Thank you, from the city council. So thank you. All right.
I know we started a little bit late, and we still have about three people left in line. So if we can keep the questions succinct, we can get through, folks. If you don't mind, we go a little bit over. I want to be respectful of everyone's time, too.
Well, I don't need a response, but I just would like to suggest some things to you. And I know you're all very much in the early childhood corner. I'm Mary Kay Stronach from St. Louis Park, and I just wanted to just identify sort of some overriding issues really quickly about as we move to decide what needs to be done statewide. And I just want to say from, 50 years of work, one of the hardest things to cope with is irregular funding. And so I just really want to encourage the big idea with the adequate funding as we move through all of these issues. And also that we need to begin to focus pretty firmly on the 0 to 3. We've been focusing very much on 3 to 5s, you know, the preschool years. And everything needs to be in the context of family support around the children, not just the child, but family support and cultural recognition. And one of the ways that families pass on culture is through their children, through the early childhood piece. So it's just really critical. So just those four things. Thanks.
Yep.
Thank you, Mary Kay.
Hi. I'm Jim Hamill from Hopkins, and I want to thank all of you for the service you provide all of us. My mission here today is to urge you folks to bring continued and enhanced support to the University of Minnesota. It is the major institution of change and discovery for our state. It is a force for our economy and for our social well-being. And I urge you to think seriously about increasing the institutional support. We have experimented statewide in recent years in loans and grants for individual students. It's not the same as institutional support. And I strongly urge you to give consideration to improving the level of support. And also, incidentally, at one point in time, we had a higher education coordinating commission that I think was less than fully or effectively functional. Now, I can be debated on that, but my point is, what are the institutional responsibilities for our various public higher education institutions? Maybe it's time to take a closer look at that. Thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you. And I couldn't agree with you more on the issue of funding. We have, you know, I served on the Higher Ed Committee for 8 years in the House and the Senate, and we flipped our funding model. We have. It used to be the state provided 2/3 of the cost of providing an education. Now we provide 1/3. You know, that was the one place where it was relatively easy for the state budget to cut, because the argument could be made that they can just turn to tuition to raise their revenues instead, right? And then everyone complains about tuition going up and wonders why. We flipped the model, and we've shifted the burden basically to students and their families. And it's backwards now. So it's our hope that we can restore some of those levels of funding as we continue to have more positive fund balances in the state.
Hi, my name is Kaylee Hansen Mahoney, and I live in St. Louis Park. I was wondering if there's any movement in the state Senate and House for more aggressive campaign finance laws that would help curb the influence of groups like the NRA and ALEC. This is an issue that's really important to me because I can't vote. I'm only 15, so my parents' vote sometimes can't count as much, and the money that they might donate to a campaign doesn't count as much as the support of a group like ALEC or the NRA. And I'm just wondering what's going on to address that.
First, thank you for being here. Yeah, I think
thank you
win
for
that.
Having oh. me.
I think you definitely win the award for the youngest participant. And you bring up a really hefty subject that I know our departing Representative Winkler was very hands-on and very instrumental in trying to push legislation through. We have a great new champion in the House with Representative Halverson, who's picked up where he left off on a lot of bills, and there's been a package introduced by Representative Halverson and Thiessen that really takes a bite into the campaign finance reform. I'm on government operations and elections, and I look forward to possibly getting a hearing in there. Representative Sanders has been very reticent to give hearings and had only had an informational one for Representative Winkler before he left. So as we keep saying, keep the pressure on. It's very, very, very important because it tips the scales of democracy and takes it away from individuals. So really something we need to keep moving on.
Absolutely. So thank you for being here. And I think your voice in particular is very important. You make a very compelling argument as a 15-year-old who cannot vote, but also is informed on the issues, that this is something that we need to do. I think some of the I don't know about you, but, you know, the presidential race is in the fall, and I'm already sick of some of the debates back and forth. And, you know, when that happens within our local community through, you know, attack pieces and direct mail and millions of dollars being spent in House and Senate races, that's not who we are as Minnesotans. Checking out the Disclose Act that Representative Youakim talked about is a really good first start. And thank you for being a young person involved in the process.
Go to your caucus.
Yep, you can still go to your caucus, absolutely. That's right.
Go to your caucus.
Okay,
yeah.
Last okay. Question or comment then.
Okay, you don't need to respond, guys, to this. Hi, Judy Reiner, Precinct 3, St. Louis Park, formerly Hopkins, Precinct 5. First of all, to the House members, good luck during the session. No water in the Capitol building. Yeah, so if you need a cup of coffee or a restroom, good luck. The Senate has that lovely new building.
You're
going to camp there? Okay.
Which, by the way, is much more accessible to the public to participate
yes.
in the democracy than
and
the
it
Capitol
was
ever was.
It's important that that happened. So. I agree with you, Ron. A couple of quick things. You don't need to respond to this, but you know, be pushing more on the environmental issues. You know, in St. Louis Park, oh, Riley Tar and Chemical, do we know it? Yes, we do. And the EPA, the PCA, the St. Louis Park City spends $500,000 a year. And right on the border of Hopkins, when I was on planning and zoning there, we were watching that pumping station. Oh, is there going to be some creosote in our water? And so just stay with it, especially on the energy area. because we did do something in September with both legislative people at the state level and some of the federal Congress people, and it was at the Colin Powell Center in Minneapolis about sustainable energy. You know, water, wind, sun, we've got it, let's do it. So I just would ask you to do that. And also, we do need to be concerned. My home state of Maryland has the Eastern Shore, the islands that used to produce, they used to have schools and houses and seafood plants and everything. They are like the Maldives, those islands, they're going underwater, guys. Yes, the Arctic areas are melting. So just take a look at it. It's not something that you can do on a little state level that much, but you know, please do take a look and push for whatever you can. That would be my big concern. And also, I hope that you'll do something for the, I'm not from the Iron Range, not even close, but I'm concerned because the governor and Governor Dayton and Senator Bach did want to have a special session to give them a little money. And it's not just that they are not doing well, it is that all the infrastructure around them, like their supermarkets and their hardware stores are shutting down. And it's not that it's anything even close to Detroit, but that whole area could become a real problem for the state of Minnesota in the future. So please support those people. Thanks.
Thank you, Judy. And you've left one big issue for the next town hall meeting after the legislative session, and that's climate change. So
that's right.
Stay tuned.
That's
yeah,
right.
We'll fix that in the next 3 months. So thank you, all of you, for attending tonight. Your questions were great. Your comments were great. We really appreciate
thank
it.
You.